Right there, Mick. Well, thank you all for coming and good afternoon. It's a great pleasure to have so many veterans here attending for this, what is a very special day, the unveiling of the Longtown Cross, and many of you were present here this morning, I know. It's incumbent upon me to tell you a few little housekeeping things. Could you please turn off your mobile phones? Standard call, switch to silent or turn them off. We are live streaming this entire presentation. There'll be two of us speaking, me and my colleague down below, Craig Blanch, who'll talk after me in the order as on your program. We have to kick off right on time because of the streaming. At the end of the production, we will, the end of the presentation, we will show you the production that's being screened in the display of the Longtown Cross. As I say, it's a great pleasure to have so many veterans present. Some would call it brave, some might call it foolhardy to come into your company and to tell you about your battle or your war. But that indeed is what I'm about to do with some humility and a great deal of reservation and respect for what you all achieved. Probably appropriate today. We've had the news of the departure of Aretha Franklin, the Queen of Soul music, whose great song, Respect, made such a mark on my generation and probably yours, since we all belong to the same generation. As historians, we tell the stories, but we don't just do that. We try to seek an understanding of what happened and to explain often the intangible reasons why things happened the way they did, and perhaps the context that people may not have been aware of during the course of an action or a battle. And I think our research findings and our discoveries can often provide understanding for what might seem, even to survivors, just another isolated enemy action. Bearing in mind that in Vietnam, by the most current counts, there was something like 4,000 enemy contacts of various kinds during the course of our 10-year engagement. It was a busy time for soldiers, as we've heard this morning. Long Tan, of course, is so well known, and I'm not going to talk you through the details of the battle, but that action where, among all those many fierce actions fought by soldiers in various places, some of them forgotten operations, forgotten battles, but they're now all recorded, at least in the official history, of which I had a great part in producing. This isolated company of just 108 men, cut off, outnumbered, at least 10 to 1, withstood those massed Viet Cong attacks for 3 hours. They suffered the heaviest Australian casualties in a single engagement in Vietnam, but they somehow prevailed against the odds. Their valiant stand has become a defining moment, an action of the war, and a memory, I should say. Yet many questions remain about that battle, particularly the strength and the dispositions of the enemy forces, what their plans were, what the enemy were attempting to achieve, their intentions and plans, and how they viewed the outcome, because of course both sides reported a very different outcome from this battle. That's what I'm going to talk you through here based on interviews and with enemy commanders and soldiers and former enemy, and as well as Australian operational records, which are very helpful, but increasingly, Vietnamese histories, communist Vietnam histories, have been published in this country and have started to be translated, particularly by one person I should note. I stand on the shoulders of giants here in talking to you about Long Tan and about the Vietnam War, particularly my late colleague, Dr. Ian McNeil, who served in I Corps, the first corps in Vietnam, the most northerly corps, as the senior Australian advisor, and later wrote the volume of the official history, Too Long Tan. notably Lex Macaulay, one of the great authors of the war, and of course many who've added since in their interpretations, Harry Smith, Dave Sabin, Charles Mollison in his book, Terry Burstall, Kevin O'Brien of the Defence Honours and Awards Appeals Tribunal. Many indeed, and I've mentioned Brigadier Ernie Chamberlain, who's a former senior intelligence officer who's translated and published many of these Vietnam histories that we now, and documents that we now rely upon. So those three sets of main questions that revolve around this question of the Battle of Long Tan. A little bit of scene setting, as if you didn't know, there is that long black shape, some have said like a large prawn, on that long string, the archipelago of islands running from Northern Australia to Vietnam. It seems so far away in our consciousness before the war and now so close in many ways. Images that many of you veterans would be familiar with, the relentless patrolling that became part of the Australian Task Force activity from the middle of 1966. Soldiers put out for long patrols to try and achieve security in the areas around Phuc Thuy province. We had taken the province of Phuc Thuy for our battlefield, for our area of operations, following a not totally successful affiliation with the Americans in 173rd Airborne Brigade with the 1st Battalion that served. But now the Australian Task Force was to be an independent force from mid-1966, established in its own province, Phuc Thuy province, that you see there in that map. Probably not too easy to read at the back, but the task force was established right in the heart of the province, throwing down the gauntlet to the enemy. And of course, the enemy was increasingly on the upsurge, starting with the guerrilla forces, the local district forces, all the way up to the local provincial mobile battalion, particularly the Australians referred to as Phuc Thuy's own D445 battalion. And then, of course, from the provincial forces to the main force regiments of 5 VC Division. Which of these were all involved in this battle is still to be fully determined, because the histories are somewhat obscured depending which history you consult and which piece of communist propaganda is used. This enemy was increasingly building up its strength and its professionalism, its proficiency with modern weapons and so on, at about the time the task force was lodged there. 2 battalions, 5 RAR and 6 RAR, 2 infantry battalions with supporting arms. 6, of course, was the one that was going to be experiencing this battle. Bringing down the Ho Chi Minh Trail reinforcements, fresh supplies, new forces coming down continually from the north. But it was the local forces that were the first problem for the Australians as they extended their TAOR, Tactical Area of Responsibility, out initially to one line alpha around a distance roughly approximating enemy mortar range outside the task force base in the first stage of what would be the application of the Australian method of operations, that oil stain effect, as it's often been called, or ink spot effect, trying to gradually expand the area of operations. Increasingly, an enemy that was being replenished from the north with much more professional North Vietnamese Army soldiers, well indoctrinated, as you see here, extremely committed politically to the cause of driving out what was often depicted as yet another colonising imperial invader. Mortars became crucial. Amongst the panoply of modern weapons they had, and you see men there armed with AK-47s, webbing, modern equipment, mortars, of course, dominated the beginning of the Battle of Long Tan. They overnight mortared the base on the 17th of August in the very early hours to draw out, it seems, from their own accounts, a reaction force. That is the base there as it developed in 1967. With 2 battalions, still a third about to come, and Centurion tanks. The task force was continually expanding right through until the peak years of 68, 69, 70. But at the time this battle occurred, the task force had only been set up around this small hill of Nui Dat, little more than a mound, in an old disused rubber plantation, and looked something like this. 6 RAR were lodged in the distant rubber trees over here, 5 RAR in the foreground. Luscombe Field, the strip, is still being developed, and the big fuel bladders here, surrounded by buns to provide fuel for the task force. The hill of Nui Dat remains there today. That's a photograph taken in 1996, but it just about denuded completely. Only Luscombe Field remains today, the strip. So, as I say, on the early hours of the 17th of August, the base was mortared and the response was quick. Patrols were sent out, and again, this is far too busy for you to see at the back, but you get the sense of it from all the lines. Patrols of three companies moving through the area, trying to locate the mortar base plates and trying to search for the enemy. SAS patrols were also mounted. They're not listed on that diagram. But more to the point, enemy intelligence had been coming in a different way, a new way, through radio direction finding or signals intelligence. A radio transmitter had been picked up moving towards the task force base by this unit 275 VC regiment, one of the strongest regiments of the main force VC, 5th Division, a very strong and experienced and tough unit. This was moving on a basis of about a kilometre a day towards the task force, quite sinister, coming in from the 29th of July to the 14th of August, when it stopped 4 days before the battle, just around the site of the battle, at a hill called Nui Dat 2, Dirt Hill 2, slightly smaller than the hill that is at the centre of the task force base, and about 5 kilometres from the centre of the base. That information could not be passed on because of the tight security restrictions on information from signals intelligence, which was a highly secret operation. It could not be passed on to the company commanders and not even to the battalion commander involved in this action. A serious omission, as it would turn out, because they went out looking for what they thought would be nothing more than a heavy weapons section of a local guerrilla unit. Harry Smith, commanding D Company, got his three platoons to the site very quickly of the Longtown rubber plantation, met with B Company, who'd been searching and had harboured overnight there. They exchanged information, and Harry moved his platoons forward into the rubber plantation. This part of the story is all well told in many accounts, not the least by Harry Smith himself in his own book. He pushed them forward in a two-up position, two platoons up in front of the others. And very quickly, by 4:20, they had come under attack, particularly 11 platoon, the rightmost platoon in the front two platoons, virtually surrounded and very quickly lost a large number of troops. 10 attempted to relieve 11 platoon and came under heavy fire itself. It was soon clear that they were up against a much tougher enemy than they had struck before. This, at this stage, was probably main force 5 VC. Regiments, 275, definitely carrying most of the weight of the attack. 12 platoon, Dave Sabin is here today, and I thank him for coming. He may have his own views on this. Dave was commanding 12 platoon, which then attempted to support 11 and came under very heavy fire itself. It's interesting to see that what we've put together as a history of these actions is replicated pretty closely in the now available D445 battalion history. Initially, they denied that 275 had been involved in this. It had all been a great victory and an achievement for 275 Regiment. Now we notice in this history, the red over here, contrary to the standard markings, these are Warsaw Pact markings for a map. They are the red. They are actually the blue, we would say, for our friendly forces or our forces. Three battalions are marked as being part of 5 VC Regiment and their headquarters directing operations just behind Nui Dat 2, this other hill. We can never know much more about the battle than what soldiers remember in their own individual little sections of that battle. It's a tunnel effect when they're fighting. Probably one of the best reproductions given us of the sensation of the battle to soldiers was the painting. Done by Bruce Fletcher, our first of only two official war painters, war artists, who were appointed to Vietnam. Fletcher captured much of the detail of what then became. We heard a little of the description this morning from Dave Sabin in his talk. A deluge of monsoonal rain, accompanied by the noise and chaos of artillery and small arms fire. In this rubber plantation, a mud mist rose from the ground from the torrential downpour mixing with the famous red mud of Phuc Thuy province, giving some protection to the men, some concealment, as well as they group together in a company all-round defence position, as they finally started to take further and further assaults, they had the benefit of a slight reverse slope that gave them some protection from enemy fire. Fletcher, as I say, captured much of this in the detail of his painting. People will tell you it's not great art, and it probably isn't, but it's a very evocative painting of the realism of the situation. He telescoped some of the action. The reinforcement, the resupply of ammunition wasn't dropped by slung load. It came in from helicopters bravely flying through a break in the weather and a break in the artillery fire to drop the boxes wrapped in blankets to supply the men. And the headlights of the APCs who came as a relief force, Harry Smith would insist, I say, as reinforcements, not a relief force. They dropped them directly down into that area. Another form of art, just to give you another side on the Battle of Long Tan, this was a sketch given to us by Maurice Stanley, the man who directed the artillery fire as a forward observer with 161 field artillery battery. He depicted himself and how his situation was as he calmly directed the fire. Behind one tree, which he said was much heavier, thicker than the trees depicted in Fletcher's painting. The detail is too small for you to see probably, but there he is with his rifle next to his radio operator, Willie Walker, who actually climbed a rubber tree at the height of the battle to string a 3-metre aerial up into a rubber tree to maintain contact with the base. He was in the end directing all three batteries of fire, firing in support, in very close support of the position. The relief force only got away very, very late from the base at Nui Dat here and took a circuitous route that only brought them up to close to the position by around 6 o'clock. And then they had to fight their way through a force of D-445 crossing them, clearly coming in to close what was to be this ambush on the force under fire. Again, you'll see that depicted in the same drawing here. The enemy have depicted most of the elements of what happened in this battle. Harry, of course, telling the story just several days later to the media, is showing a pretty much the same sort of picture of his platoons in position going forward into what would be this 3-hour pitch battle to hold off massive forces assembled against them. My late colleague and co-author, Ian McNeil, visited the site 22 years later. He is depicted here with the then commander of D-445 battalion, the man here still in uniform, but more importantly, the man in the white shirt just here. It's the man reputed to have been the commander during the battle. Ian always had some reservations about the ambiguities of Lieutenant Colonel Nguyen Van Kim's claims. He was probably more of a political commissar and was certainly spokesman for the District Communist People's Committee on the battle. More importantly was the man standing next to him here, who was the commander of C2 Company of D-445 Battalion in the battle. All of them gave frank and fairly clear advice on the battle to Ian. Can I just take you back a couple of steps and you'll see C2 Company marked out here. The maps were laid on the ground. The movements of both sides were mapped out. Agreement was reached on many of the activities that went on. There's Colonel Kim and the commander of C2 Company right next to him. But there were huge differences over the casualties inflicted on both sides and huge differences over the numbers involved. In the end, Kim was claiming there were no more than 700 to 800 soldiers of D-445 Battalion with support from local guerrilla forces. This didn't marry with the Australian view that if 275 Regiment had been involved, this would have been a much larger force of the order of almost 2,000 troops arrayed against the Australians. They also had great differences on the casualties. It was clear to them that this had been a major victory because their communist propaganda had told them so at the very conclusion of the battle. It had been announced that they had killed 500 Australians, knocked out 21 tanks. Handbills were circulated around the province stating much of this. When Ian produced the after-action reports to show them our view of the battle, although they couldn't read English, they could see the disparity between the numbers, listing 245 enemy killed and 17 Australian one died of wounds. They laughed at this and said it was preposterous. Clearly our propaganda was very, very good. Maybe if the Australians had concealed the 500 dead in the total number of died in the Vietnam War, which is a very similar number to what they claimed. They would not move from this position. They were, as Ian described it, captives of their recent past. The propaganda was stronger than any scholarship. It took another couple of years before Ian talked to another person who was crucial in this operation, and that was the former operations officer of the 5VC division, Colonel Nguyen Tan Hong. Hong made it quite clear that what they had set out to do was not attack the base, which was a very strong theory still being proposed to this day, that this was a force heading towards the base. That was the opposite of communist tactical doctrine and measures. They would normally try and lure the tiger down from the mountain, as they said metaphorically, and then attack him in the rice field. This was the idea here, to draw out a large reaction force after mortaring the base. They certainly succeeded in doing that, but it wasn't the large force they had hoped for. They had hoped to issue a resounding bloody nose to Australia and perhaps change our political commitment to this war by perhaps annihilating a battalion, if lucky. They were not heading for the base, Hong maintained. They didn't have the forces for it. They didn't have the heavy weapons to attack a defended base, even though they knew from the movements they'd been observing that the base wasn't that heavily defended at the time. They wouldn't have risked that. The standard communist procedure was to actually prepare the battlefield well for the operation, to have an overwhelming superiority of force, apply it rapidly, and withdraw quickly once the victory had been achieved. In Dave Sabin's wonderful fictional account this morning, and I mean fictional in the best way here, Dave, he resurrected the view from, and he's done this in a book that he published, from a fictional enemy commander's position, looking at how this battle unfolded to the enemy commander. The one thing that was missing from Dave's excellent account was what Hong had said in his operations orders to the battalions, that the battle had to be over quickly. This was the standard communist practice. This had to be done in 2 hours, he said. If not, they had to withdraw. Clearly what happened here didn't go according to plans, and Hong agreed. They had launched the attempt at an ambush too soon. They had misread their enemy. They had assumed it to be a far larger force than it was because of Harry's widely dispersed platoons. They had also got themselves so hooked in, to use the terminology of the time, that it was difficult for them to extract themselves from this battle. And so it was costing them heavily. They had come in close. They knew that they were within artillery range. In fact, the optimum artillery range from the base, about 5 kilometres. That's where the 105 howitzers had their most deadly effect. But they couldn't pull back further. The idea was to actually draw the Australians out, annihilate them in this position, and then leave a couple of, this is Hong's plan, to leave a force from 274 Regiment, the other 5 VC Division Regiment, in position on Route 2 to ambush any American forces coming south to the relief of the surrounded and besieged D Company. They also had set up a further ambush on a withdrawal route to try and draw any relieving forces into a further ambush further out. So they had really set this up well. It was a very clever, rather complicated scheme of triple ambushes, but that depended on very, very good communications that the VC lacked. They did not have the tactical radios that the task force had. They relied upon telephone lines, which by now would have been destroyed by the massive artillery. Bugle calls, which were used continually, so the Australians grew used to the fact. They knew that with a particular sequence of bugle calls, it would obviously mean assemble, make ready, and then attack. This was repeatedly used, the human way of attacks. Hong also admitted that they had misjudged the enemy. The enemy's movements had deceived them. They thought they were confronting a much larger force than they were, and clearly Harry's manoeuvring of those platoons had given him, in many cases, the advantage, often unconsciously, it has to be said. He had achieved an advantage as he was manoeuvring the platoons where possible. And there we have the very young Dave Sabin going back in the next day. I put this in here because this is a one bit of photographic evidence that matches the evidence of the soldiers the next day when they saw the damage that 108 men had done at the loss of pretty well a third of their number in repelling this much larger force. We'll never know how large actually it was at any time. Probably the most that they could muster at any time in the attacks might have been 1,000 men. There may have been many, many more assembled there for this attempt to change political circumstances as much as to win a battle on the battlefield. As they went over the battlefield, we've heard this story before, and you'll see it again in the very moving production associated with the Longtown Cross. They kept coming across shocking scenes of bodies. The count stopped at 180 bodies and pieces of bodies that were gathered and counted. At the end, the official report was 245. It may well have been many, many more. Three enemy wounded were found, prisoners were taken and interrogated. The number may have been many more, but it's continued to grow as the communist number, curiously, has continued to come down in recent years. As they have adjusted in their histories, their more outlandish claims of propaganda, and have come to the conclusion that maybe the Australian losses were much closer to the figure we recorded. On the other hand, from our side, the numbers keep escalating. There was a new film, a feature film being made by Red June. I met Martin Walsh, the producer, here today. And I didn't upbraid him, but I know that there has been publicity claiming that 800 VC died and over 1,000 were wounded. That figure simply doesn't tally with the research done by people like Ernie Chamberlain with his rigorous analysis of everything from the communist records, even down to the quartermaster reports, the quartermaster notebook, which give the numbers before and after the contact. The enemy prisoners were discovered and captured. Huge quantities of weapons, which again give the lie to this being just a small operation. Massive quantities of captured weapons, which took a large amount of storage to take back to the task force and gave the boys some fun later on when they had a field day to test them. Harry Smith there testing the heavy machine gun, which is in our collection here at the memorial, together with Company Sergeant Major Jack Kirby, Big Jack Kirby, who was awarded the DCM for his actions on that day and tragically died 6 months later in some misdirected artillery fire on a company headquarters. Again, testing the heavy machine gun, testing mortars. Back to the battlefield. On the battlefield, two wounded were discovered, and you'll hear the very poignant story of one of them in this production at the end of today's presentation. Jim Richmond being found here, platoon sergeant of the 11th platoon, Bob Buick, attending Jim Richmond, who had been hit badly and spent the entire night on the battlefield. And there he is responding well to treatment in a US Army hospital. One other man found on the battlefield afterwards, Barry Custard Miller, who happened to survive as well, again with severe wounds, facial and his leg. Barry was at least standing when found and was able to lean against a rubber tree and say to the troops as they came back in, the very men who'd fought the battle the day before, the men from D Company came back in to clear the battlefield. Harry Smith had insisted that they get back on the horse. And his phrase, and I think I can say it even though we're live streaming, is, you blokes took your fucking time. Harry receiving his military cross, along with his platoon commanders, Dave Sabin there in the middle, and Jeff Kendall of 10 Platoon. Of course, Gordon Sharp, the commander, 2nd Lieutenant commanding 11 Platoon, had been killed in the very first exchanges of fire of the action, and command had fallen to Bob Buick. On the left, Adrian Roberts, who couldn't be with us here today, regrettably, the commander of the APC troop that brought the relief force of A Company to the rescue, as it were. Although Harry denies he needed rescuing. He had everything under control. In a shameful act, at the last minute when the South Vietnamese, the Republic of Vietnam, wanted to give awards to the survivors, heroism awards, unit citation, they were told at the last minute that the Australians couldn't accept foreign awards. Of course, our awards were imperial awards or British awards, but 15 of those were actually issued at the time, including the Military Cross to Harry Smith, MIDs to various others, including Dave Seven and Adrian Roberts and Jeff Kendall. Later upgraded, quite belatedly, as they should have been. These men received as a token in short notice cigar boxes and dolls in traditional dress, which was, it was laughed at the time, but it was still a desperate measure by the South Vietnamese to thank the Australians. And I believe those items became quite highly prized later on. 15 awards were awarded, ranging from DSOs to the task force commander and the battalion commander, who only arrived on the scene when it was over. There was much disgruntlement about that later on. I think Ian McNeill summed it up best in a footnote in his official history when he said that the scale and number of awards issued was little short of insulting, given the bravery displayed. I agree with him. And later, there was much rectification of that, but it took Harry Smith 20 years of fighting another battle to get justice for his soldiers. And in two tranches, further awards were either upgraded or awarded. There's Bob Buick receiving his military medal. Sergeant Bob Buick of 11th Platoon. Eggleton, somebody please, Jeff Eggleton, I think it was. Thanks, Dave. Receiving, corporal, receiving the same. And DCM for Jack Kirby at a parade. Harry Smith being congratulated by the South Vietnamese Australian ambassador to South Vietnam on his military medal, which he's proudly wearing there. Of course, the story of the Longtown Cross is all bound up in this, and that's why we're here today, and that story will be told by my colleague, Craig Blanch, and along with a short presentation that I've been talking about, this wonderful production telling the story of the cross. So I won't steal Craig's thunder with that. Just to say that there it is being dedicated in 1969, 3 years after this action. Nine soldiers who'd served in the Battle of Longtown were there in that guard around the Longtown Cross, and there they are. What is less well known is that, and we do know, that the North Vietnamese, when the communist takeover of Vietnam, South Vietnam occurred, destroyed pretty well every old sign of the regime. All of the memorials were destroyed. This has almost been forgotten in time. This memorial was opened on Australia Day 1973, just before the last of the Australians, the embassy guard, left in the middle of that year. It was the day before the ceasefire was announced in Paris, calling a halt to the war that would last for a couple of years, in effect. That memorial depicted in its centre, and it was raised and funded, the money was raised and it was funded by South Vietnamese people and the local district, and that indeed is the Phuc Thuy province chief, and here the ambassador, the Australian ambassador. At the centre of the memorial stands a red marble, or leaps, a red marble kangaroo. You may be able to see it from back there. Of course, the task force vehicles were all marked with an Australian insignia of a red kangaroo, and they bore the local term from the local Phuc Thuy inhabitants of the red rats of Phuc Thuy, not knowing what a kangaroo was. Their initial proposal was to build a giant memorial of a red kangaroo. We can be grateful, I think, that we have the Longtown Cross instead of the big kangaroo to visit today. There it stands to this day, the replica, and you'll hear more about that from Craig. I think I'll leave you just with one thing, the roll of honour from the Battle of Longtown. 18 soldiers died, 17 killed in wounds, 17 killed in action, one died of wounds, 24 wounded, three evacuated with battle shock, which is something you don't hear about from the Vietnam War, a feature of the First World War perhaps, but quite indicative of the intensity of this battle. They were an average age of 21, 11 of them were national servicemen, men who had accepted their call-up notice, trained for 6 months to a year, and found themselves in Vietnam defending Australia's government policy to try and support the emergence of an independent democratic republic. With that, I'll end my presentation and hand over to Craig, who's put a tremendous amount of work in the last few months and has found out more about the Longtown Cross and its mysterious history than I think anyone ever knew before, any single person ever knew before. And it's quite an interesting story. So please welcome Craig. Thank you.
Thanks, Ashley. Glad to see you didn't put any pressure on me there at all. As Ashley said, the last few months have been quite extraordinary journey for me in curating the new exhibition of the Long Tan Cross. It was quite daunting at the beginning, but I must say anyone that's curated an exhibition here knows that there's an awful lot of people that work behind the scenes to make them a success, and we have extraordinary teams here, exhibitions and photo, film and sound, our collection services. Really the unsung heroes here. I just put a few words together and tick off on stuff. So also it's many, many veterans have assisted this particular production and this particular project. I can't thank them all, but they're listed on the end of the 10-minute production at the end. And I just say to them, you will be acknowledged two times an hour for the next whenever. But joining us today, I'm happy to say, are three of those people. It's Barry McAvenue, who was an assault pioneer in 1969, was tasked with actually creating the cross. So thanks, Barry, for giving me a job. Lieutenant Colonel retired Len Johnson, who, as Major Len Johnson in 1969, was operations officer in Vietnam with 6RAR, and Archdeacon Peter Dillon. I'm being told he's in the audience. I was going to say Archdeacon Peter Dillon retired, but I don't know if Archdeacons retire. But Peter was officiated at the Long Tan Cross dedication in 1969. And of course, Dave Sabin, a company commander from the battle itself. Very, very warm welcome there. The Battle of Long Tan on the 18th of August 1966 cost the lives of 18 Australians. One from 3 Troop, 1 APC Squadron, and 17 from Delta Company, 6 Battalion, the Royal Australia Regiment, in a very few hours. There is no doubt that the battle has caught the imagination of many. That so many died was tragic. That so many lived almost defies explanation. Leadership, training, unerring support, and inspirational acts of courage ensured its place in military history. This monument was placed on the site of the battle 3 years later. At the time, there was little to suggest that this simple memorial would even survive, much less become a symbol of the war in Vietnam. The first mention of the memorial service for the fallen at Long Tan occurred in a meeting attended by 6RAR's commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel David Butler, the adjutant, Captain Michael Harris, and Butler's 2IC at the time, Major Len Johnson. It was convened in the weeks leading up to the battalion's second tour of Vietnam in May 1969. The mention was brief, referring only to a service that should be held as close as possible to the third anniversary of the battle. The exact date of the service that at that time could not be set, as it would have to fit in with the operational requirements once they were in Vietnam. Soon after arriving in Vietnam, the battalion was joined by 2 New Zealand rifle companies and renamed 6RAR NZ Anzac. An Anzac battalion was an apt designation for a unit that would erect a cross to a battle that was fought by soldiers from both countries 3 years earlier. It is also worth noting that the US Presidential Unit Citation awarded to Delta Company for extraordinary heroism at Long Tan was also extended to the 3 New Zealand artillerymen attached to the company that day, Captain Murray Stanley, Bombardier Murray Broomhall, and Lance Corporal Willie Walker. The idea of manufacturing a cross for a ceremony to be held on the actual battle site was made by Butler from a hospital bed in Vung Tau after he was wounded on the 21st of July 1969 during Operation Munding Burra. The deep symbolism of the monument is understandable. Butler grew up in a devoutly Christian household, and his father was a Methodist minister. He also knew the cost of war long before he was a soldier. As a young teenager, he had lost a brother on HMAS Sydney in November 1941. The name of the operation in which he was wounded, Munding Burra, refers to a suburb in Townsville where Butler had wanted to hold a church service for the battalion at St Matthews before leaving Australia. The task of manufacturing the cross was given to Corporal Barry McAvenue of the Assault Pioneer Platoon, who scrounged the material from around the base. He had to hammer out the bent and gnarled 3/8 inch steel rod that he found in the rubbish tip before he could use it to reinforce the concrete. He thought the plain cross just didn't look right when he drew the plan on the wall of the shed, so he added the gussets, giving it its distinctive shape. Operation Munding Burra ended on the 15th of August, allowing the battalion a small window in which to have the service on the actual anniversary of the Battle of Long Tan. Operation Long Tan, as the ceremonial service and cross installation was known, was a battalion household event of no military operational importance and had to be squeezed in between two major operations, Munding Burra, that had cost the battalion 54 casualties, with 11 killed from the battalion and support units, and Operation Burnham, that was to begin just 9 days later. The need for a formal operational order, drawn up by the then Major Len Johnson on the 9th of August, was due to the fact that the Long Tan battle site was still a dangerous and enemy-held area around 5 kilometres outside the task force base at Nui Dat. The operation parameters for Operation Long Tan were simple. It was to be conducted totally by 6RARNZ. It had to be completed within 1 day, and it could not interfere in any way with the preparation and planning for upcoming operations. Initially, two companies and support elements were committed to an air assault into the area to secure the site at 2 p.m. on the afternoon of the 17th of August. And that's these two here. A Company, with two sections of the Assault Pioneer Platoon, along with Operation Headquarters, guides from W Company, an artillery forward observer, mortar fire controller and interpreters, as well as D Company, with three sections of the Assault Pioneer Platoon, Anti-Tank Platoon, RSM Party, V&B Company's Harbour Parties and Guides, Artillery Forward Observer, Mortar Fire Controller and Interpreters. There was a last-minute change, however, when permission to use the aircraft in an unsecured landing zone was withheld. A Company was sent in a troop of APCs, secured the landing zone, and D Company followed soon after in the helicopters. Among the members of Delta Company was Neil Rankin, one of 10 Battle of Long Tan veterans present on their second tour of Vietnam. For the ceremony to take place the following day, he was given the distinction of being the honour guard commander. It was decided that the spot on which the cross would sit was to be the position of 11 platoon stand, where 13 of their company were killed. Rankin surveyed the field and marked the spot with the heel of his boot. D Company harboured that night around the spot chosen by Rankin. And for those who are unfamiliar with the term harboured, it is basically a defensive formation. I had to crystal that down a bit, Len, sorry. Barry Clark, a Lance Corporal with the company, describes the next few hours. "We secured the area. It was spooky too. because you knew those 18 Aussies were killed and you were lying in the same area. You didn't get much sleep that night. A&D companies had by 8 a.m. the following morning to clear the area of operations of any enemy. D Company and the assault platoon sections were then given 2 hours to prepare the site and install the cross. It was to face south at the request of the chaplain, Padre Bill Mills. Clark continues, "In the morning they brought in a helicopter. It was emotional. You saw the helicopter and the wash of the blades and heard the noise, and it just lowered the cross down. And we put the cross there. While the site was being prepared, A Company was securing routes from defensive harbour positions to the cross site and rendezvous areas for the imminent arrival of the troops for the ceremony. The remaining elements of 6RARNZ, B, V and W companies then arrived to their relative harbour positions, located as to provide a security cordon around the ceremony site. You can see this cordon of harbours here. A platoon was left as overwatch at each position as the remaining troops moved to the ceremony. Besides Neil Rankin, the other 9 Long Tan veterans making up the honour guard were D Company's Corporal Richard Brown, Lance Corporal Malcolm Campbell, Corporal Brian Riley, Sergeant John Beer, Corporal George Richardson, Corporal William Akell, Corporal Brian Halls, Corporal Bill Roach, and three troop 1APC squadrons, Corporal William O'Rourke. Before the ceremony, the cross had already started to become a symbol of broader commemoration. It was particularly poignant, not only for those remembering mates killed in the battle, but also for those who had lost mates killed in the weeks leading up to the ceremony itself, including Mick Storen, whose story would become immortalised in John Schumann's song, Only 19. 14 had been killed from 6RARNZ and their support units in the short time they had been in Vietnam. There are also a further 20 from their first tour, including their inspirational Battle of Long Tan Company Sergeant Major, Jack Kirby, DCM, who was killed in tragic circumstances a few months after the battle. 3 chaplains officiated at the ceremony that began at precisely 11 a.m. Protestant Padre Noel Mills, known to his friends as Bill, who was attached to 6RAR and was most involved in the organisation of the dedication of the cross. Catholic Padre Hank Nolan, and Anglican Padre Peter Dillon. When Dillon walked onto the site, he was taken aback by the destruction still evident. Rubber trees smashed, and the detritus of the battle still lying about, including an old rusty enemy AK-47 rifle. With the ceremony underway, readings were done by Lieutenant Colonel Butler, the chaplains, and the officers commanding the cavalry squadron and 161 battery of the New Zealand Artillery. The Regimental Sergeant Major, James Cruikshank, read out the roll of honour for the battalion. Dillon remembers it as a very solemn occasion, made even more haunting by the pipers. By midday, the ceremony was complete, and the companies returned to their harbour positions to await extraction, which was completed by mid-afternoon. In a hostile environment, both militarily and environmentally, and against most expectations, the cross survived. In May 1970, not long before the battalion's return to Australia, Lieutenant Colonel Butler tasked the battalion's mortar platoon commander, Captain James Horan, to take a patrol to the cross to check on its condition, clean as necessary, and to pay their respects on behalf of the battalion. The members of the patrol were selected by Horan and consisted of soldiers of his own platoon and the assault pioneers. On arriving in the general area, monsoonal rain, heavy mist, thick regrowth in the gloomy half-light of the plantation had made finding the cross difficult. At around mid-afternoon, it was eventually sighted about 75 metres away. But it was too far away and too late to reach it safely that day. Though Horan was sorely tempted to push on and be back at the base by nightfall, he decided against taking any chances so close to going home. Casualties from mines during their tour had been considerable, and the mine detectors used by the party were rendered useless by the amount of metal debris still present from the battle almost 4 years earlier. Also, attempting to enter through the task force base perimeter at dusk would present its own dangers. Instead, the patrol went into defensive harbour and spent the night on the wet ground. At dawn, the patrol crept towards the cross, the assault pioneers searching the ground for mines with bayonets and mine prodders. It was an apprehensive few hours to cover a very short distance. They reached the cross, and like others before them and those that followed, were surprised at its condition, not vandalised by the Viet Cong or damaged by artillery or mortar fire. By now the chain surrounded gone, but the plaque was still in place. The patrol cleaned the cross, polished the plaque, paid their respects with a minute's silence and lest we forget. Their duty done, the last patrol of 6RAR NZ ANZAC to visit the cross returned to Nui Dat. The reason that the cross itself was relatively untouched is believed by some to be its shared symbolism, supported by perhaps by an experience of Padre Mills during Operation Ross with 6RAR NZ a few weeks after the ceremony. While searching a house that had been quickly abandoned by the VC, Mills looked in an old cupboard and found flares, smoke grenades, bicycle tools, rice wine, a plaster statue of the Madonna, some religious pictures and a crucifix. It had obviously been there for some time, and Mills himself believed that it may have belonged to a guerrilla of the Viet Minh who had fought the French in the Indochina War of the 50s. Mills used the crucifix for a communion service the very next day. He returned to Australia in 1970, but sadly died the following year from an illness attributed to his war service. His is the only name on the memorial's roll of honour for the Royal Australian Army Chaplains Department. I believe the crucifix is still with the family. Anniversary services were held over the following 2 years. In 1970, more than 50 soldiers, including the 1st Australian Task Force Commander, Brigadier William Henderson, attended the memorial service there. And on the 18th of August 1971, APC scoured the area, whilst about 60 members of 1ATF attended the service, including Commander Brigadier Bruce MacDonald. It was to be the last anniversary service to be held before the original cross. The last units of the task force to visit the site were two platoons of New Zealand's Victor 6 Company of 4RAR NZ ANZAC. They rendezvoused at the cross on the 5th of November 1971 and harboured overnight. At 6:20 a.m. 2 days later, they arrived back through the wire at Nui Dat and had just enough time for a quick bite, a clean-up, before boarding caribous bound for Vung Tau and home. The 1st Australian Task Force base was abandoned later that day. It is fitting that the last Australian to see the original Long Tan Cross in situ happened to be a Battle of Long Tan veteran. Kevin Chico Miller served two tours in Vietnam. He was a section commander with 12 Platoon, D Company, 6RAR at the Battle of Long Tan, and returned to Vietnam in 1972. During this tour, he was a member of the Australian Army Training Team, Vietnam, serving with the US Army's Phuc Thuy Training Battalion of Cambodian soldiers to fight the Khmer Rouge. On the 31st of October 1972, at his request, Kevin was given the task of patrolling the Long Tan rubber plantation area in the hope of seeing the cross he knew had been erected there. he located 6RAR's final defensive position, thinking that it had been erected there but found nothing. He then did a sweep of the battle area and came across the cross, almost unseen in the undergrowth, on the site of 11 platoon stand. And you can see there, I don't apologise for the clarity of the images, because the fact that we have them at all is quite a miracle. But this is Kevin Miller standing in front of the cross. By now the plaque has disappeared as well, but again the cross is virtually untouched. One of the corner posts remains standing. The cross was in good condition. The plaque was gone. They cleaned up the site before leaving. Within weeks, the Whitlam government ordered the last remaining of troops to Vietnam to leave. Sometime after the withdrawal of the Australians, the cross was torn from its mount and used as a grave marker for a local, Nguyen Van Chinh. His name is still visible on the cross to this day. In August 1987, Terry Burstall, another Long Tan veteran, was in Vietnam for research on the battle and asked the Vietnamese veterans of the war about the cross. He didn't particularly go there to search out the cross at that stage. He was just at the battle site doing research. Most of them remembered it standing, but they had no idea of what became of it. In November 8, 1987, within weeks of the Vietnam Veterans Welcome Home Parade in Sydney, Burstall returned to Vietnam and was taken to the Long Tan village, where he was shown the cross on the dirt floor of a shed. It was without its plaque, but this was found a few days later. He informed the AWM and protracted, but unsuccessful until now, negotiations began almost immediately to have the cross brought to Australia permanently. And it was it's interesting to note that Terry, when he saw the cross, it didn't really mean much to him at all. It's when they cleaned up the plaque that it became a living thing to him. Instead of the cross coming to Australia, it was instead declared National Historic Property by the Vietnamese government and moved to the Dong Noi Museum in Ben Hoa City. And here you see it in 1988 when Ashley's colleague Ian McNeil was in Vietnam doing research and also doing some negotiations for the return of the cross. And you see it here in the basement of the museum. That's just a later one over here, thanks to Walter Pearson, of the cross as displayed later in the museum. In 1988, ex-3RAR veteran John Sanders visited Vietnam and was so moved by the poverty in the area that he returned to Australia to begin efforts to assist them. He organised donations of books and medical supplies, as well as the transport required to get them to Vietnam. To highlight their efforts, Sanders promoted the visit heavily and organised a dawn service at Long Tam to be held on Anzac Day 1989. By this time, the Long Dat District People's Committee had installed a replica cross at the site as a gesture of reconciliation and remembrance, as well as being a focus for Australians to return and to help in the reconstruction of their economy. Lee Tran, a decorated former enemy D-445 soldier, went to pains to ensure that the replica was as faithful as possible to the placement and orientation of the original. This would have been assisted by the existence of the original footings that still sit at the base of the replica. Those that lay a wreath at the base of the replica are laying them over the missing section of the original cross here now in the memorial. It is a significant link. This image here was taken by Terry Burstall in 1987, showing the quite distinctive footings of where the original was. And this was taken in 1989, and Lee Tran put the cross as close as he could to the remnants of the original. So it's essentially a monument to a monument. At around 6:30 on the morning of the 25th of April 1989, the dawn service was held at the Long Tan Cross, attended by Sanders, ex-SAS veteran Paddy Backsky, and 2AR NZ Anzacs Graham Wheeler, amongst others. The service acknowledged the dead from both sides and was covered by journalists and film crews from Channel 7, 10 and the ABC. Also were attending were enemy soldiers, representatives of the Vietnam Foreign Affairs, local officials and residents. The big banner there is friendship between the Australian peoples and the local peoples. This is John Sanders, Graham Wheeler, Paddy Backsky. This is a US Marine that happened to come along for the ceremony. There's a red rat.
Ashley, there's your red rat on the
gate. This is John Sanders being surrounded by media. Now, it's interesting that there's a couple of plaques here that didn't really last that long. This plaque here was put there to designate an historic place, but something historic took place here. It's not a memorial plaque per se. It's just as one of our historical markers that we may have in Australia here. This here, however, it says Memories of Dead Soldiers on 18th of the 8th, 1966. Next to the gate there, another plaque that didn't last particularly long, translates to a monument. Well, it doesn't translate, it's actually in English. A monument for remembering longingly of the dead at Battle of Battlefield, 18/8/1966. Now, if we just go back, you can see that was March 1989. A month later, they had transformed it into that. It was a remarkable month of work. Within months, tours of the Long Tan Cross were already being advertised. The late Vietnam veteran Albie Cunningham, who made his first pilgrimage to Long Tan in 1990 and who subsequently led more than 300 Australians to the site, said, "It was not just a memorial to the dead. It is a place where Australian veterans come to erase the ghosts of the past." The site suffered the ravages of the environment over the years, at times tended by locals, other times by visiting veterans. In August 1989, Frank O'Brien of the ADF accompanied ADF and DFAT language students to the site and found it overgrown, so they spent an hour or so doing some gardening. On the 27th anniversary of the battle in 1993, Chaplain Len Ecott conducted a service there for a group of 20 Australian soldiers who were coming to the end of their peacekeeping tour in nearby Cambodia. When they arrived, they were pleasantly surprised to find the site sparse but well cared for. The old rubber trees had been removed, replaced with a grain crop interspersed with new rubber tree plantings. There was a well-tended garden at the base of the cross. Ecock remembers being approached by a couple who lived on the edge of the crop. The woman said to Ecott something to the effect of, "It is important to remember the spirits of the dead, of all who died here, as they are now at rest together." He felt then that any service dedicated to Australians alone would be incomplete and changed his service accordingly. With the permission of the locals and led by the Australian group's commander, Lieutenant Colonel John Wheeland, they gave the site a spruce up, and the woman presented them with a replica plaque wrapped in a paper and kept in their home for safekeeping to use during the service. The following dawn, the service was held, also attended by a small group of locals. Ecott went on to become the Anglican Bishop of the Australian Defence Force, and that day in 1993 remains one of his most poignant experiences. In 1996, Jim Richmond, who had lay wounded on the battlefield overnight at Long Tan, and Susan Dury, the widow of Jack Dury, who was killed at Long Tan, joined a group of veterans and family members on a government-sponsored pilgrimage to Vietnam, led by Veterans Affairs Minister Bruce Scott. Susan laid a poppy and a small note beside the original cross at the museum, a silent tribute to her husband that she had married just 3 weeks before he left for Vietnam. For Jim, the museum was a tough experience, but he laid some ghosts to rest there. This is Bruce Scott. It was in contrast to that first Anzac Day service, it was well patronised and obviously extraordinarily ceremonial. Sensitivity started to come into play and they didn't mind people visiting the site, but they had to do it in a very respectful manner and discreetly. And as you can see here, Bruce is just laying a poppy at the base of the cross. You can see now the surrounded by cornfield. They were supposed to spend about 15 minutes there, but the way it worked out, it was about half an hour longer than that, because to do that, they decided that everybody would lay a single poppy, and that extended their time out. Jimmy Richmond himself laid 18 poppies there for obvious reasons. In the late 1990s, the Long Tan site had once again fallen into disrepair. But a few years earlier, the Australian Veterans Vietnam Reconstruction Group was formed by another Vietnam veteran, Paul Murphy. Murphy had visited Vietnam in 1990 and was distressed by the devastation the war had wrought on the local people. He also found his visit to the Long Tan site a chilling experience, and a feeling of despondency swept over him when he saw the original Long Tan cross in the museum. Murphy felt determined to do something for Vietnam and obtained permission from the Vietnamese authorities to establish an aid agency. It was no small feat. The AVVRG was finally formed in 1994 to assist in building local infrastructure, provide health services, and aid the local economy. Soon after, the AVVRG took over the upkeep of the Long Tan site, managed the visitation, and later the organisation, in conjunction with the Australian Embassy and Consulate, of official and sanctioned Long Tan Day and Anzac Day services at the cross. Money was tight in the organisation, with fundraising being its main source of income, and most of that went to community projects. By the late 1990s, the visitors to the site were growing, but the site itself was looking rather tired. In 2000, hearing of the increasing pilgrimages to the site by many Vietnam vets, not just six rah boys, Graham Smith, a former radio signaller with D Company headquarters during the Battle of Long Tan, stepped down from his role as president of the 6RAR Association to establish the Long Tan Cross Restoration Fund. The AVVRG's representative in Vietnam, Peter Mitchelson, worked closely with Smith and facilitated the cultural and logistical end of the restoration of the site. The fund was quickly oversubscribed, and a major refurbishment of the site was undertaken. 2 years later, the newly restored site was handed over to the AVVRG, which by this time the Vietnamese had appointed the organisation custodians of the site, or keepers of the cross. And here we see the site in the late 1990s and through to 2007. A remarkable transformation. Other upgrades were undertaken in 2004 and 2006. Remaining monies from the from the fund that weren't used in the original restoration were handed over to the AVVRG for their continuing work. And to date, the AVVRG's projects have not only included the Long Tan Cross, but schools and orphanage, a microfinance scheme, dental care and training in some 11 hospitals in Saigon and Vung Tu in the Vung Tui province. During the 1990s, replica crosses started to appear in Australia as a commemorative symbol of the war in Vietnam. In the early 2000s, saw a dramatic rise in the number of visitors to the Long Tan site in Vietnam, and it increasingly became a commemorative space to honour the fallen from both sides. On the 40th anniversary of the battle in 2006, Prime Minister John Howard gave a formal apology in Parliament to the Vietnam veterans for their past treatment. And in November, he became the first Australian Prime Minister to visit the site. In 2012, the original cross was brought to Australia on temporary loan, though the aspiration was to have it here, in perpetuity remained. Finally, in 2017, the Socialist Government of Vietnam generously gifted the cross to the people of Australia. In its new home, it is now a memorial and a constant reminder of the real cost of war. This is in its new home in the galleries that you will see. And this picture was taken, thanks to Walter Pearson, just a few days ago. It's an interesting time in the history of the Long Tan Cross. There are those among us to whom the cross will have a deep personal meaning. Younger faces may see a curious artefact from battle fought over half a century ago. Either way, it is now part of our national story that begins at the front of steps of this memorial. Thank you. Yes, we've got a 10-minute presentation now. It's the new production we've put together on the history of the Long Tan Cross and its commemorative purpose now. And as you can imagine, we're trying to squeeze 50 years into 10 minutes, but I think we've done a pretty good job. So, Dave, when you're ready.
This is a 3-4. A shit rep. A company signed enemy force.
It's bigger than I thought it was.
Keeping in mind that this is a group of basically 20, 21-year-olds, none of them had ever seen a dead body on the battlefield. Maybe one or two had fired a shot in anger. None had had shots returned at them. These aren't your grizzled veterans. These are young lads that you take off the street and put in the army for 6 months and send them
out. Sunray minor, Sunray is killed.
There's only two survived in my section. That was myself and John Robbins. You know, once I got hit, there's not much I could do about it. I knew most of my mates were dead around me. I had a sucking chest wound. I said a bit of shrapnel's coming through me back and I could feel all the air getting sucked in every time I took a breath. When night came, they kept the artillery going all the time. Yeah, I yelled out a couple of times during the night for a medic, but I got shot out, so I kept my mouth shut. All I could really do was just wait there and try to survive the night.
Next morning, all we wanted to do was get back onto the battlefield and reclaim those of ours that we had lost. Thankfully, we found two alive. There was death and destruction everywhere, rubber trees ripped apart by artillery, bodies ripped apart by artillery. Not our own, but the enemy. But that was still quite confronting for a 20-year-old.
I came to the 11 platoon position, my mates lying in an arc facing outwards with rifles still in the shoulder as if they were frozen in a drill and it only needed touch to bring them back to life again. They looked very peaceful and dignified, dying in place, doing their duty. And that's when the tears started.
We collected them and wrapped them in their hoochies and laid them out on the ground. It was very, very sad.
Back in Australia, somebody said 18th of August will be the third anniversary of the Battle of Long Tan. What should we do? And we agreed we should do something to commemorate that battle and the soldiers who died in it.
I assume the 2IC and Sergeant McLean come over to see me, want you to build a cross. And I says, I've never built a cross in my bloody life. And he says, oh, we want it for the 18th of August. They wanted it made out of timber originally, and we had no timber. So I says, oh, I'll make it out of concrete. And rustled up the reinforcing out of the rubbish tip, made it up, made it just a straight arms and that, and it didn't look right. So I added the gussets in the centre. And then they told me afterwards that they had an 8-inch brass plate they're going to mount on it. And I said, oh, I was lucky I did that. Fitted nicely.
There was to be an operation which required us to go 5 kilometres out of the Nui Dat Wai to where D Company, some years before, had a big battle, and to find the exact spot. We had to surround the area with a security wall of soldiers because we were in VC territory.
The site that I was looking for, that position was 11 turn. After some searching, I found the site. The rubber trees bared the scars, the small arms and heavy machine gun fire. With the heel of my boot, I did mark the site where the cross was to be erected.
There were something like 500 or 600 soldiers in there, plus the visitors. It was 11 o'clock exactly when we started the ceremony of readings. When the ceremony was finished, I was in the last APC to leave the area of the cross. When I climbed in the APC, the back door was left down, and as it drove off, the cross was in the distance about 30 metres behind. And as I was looking at it, a sudden ray of sun came down through the rubber trees and picked out the cross, just the cross. As I looked at it, I thought to myself, the VC will blow that up tonight.
We were out on operations in that area, and I asked my CO at the time if I could take a patrol out so that I could locate the cross. We did a sweep through the whole battle area. We saw the cross, and it was pretty well camouflaged with high vegetation. We couldn't hang around there for too long because it was a pretty dangerous area. So we just cleaned it up as best we could, and then we took a couple of photos and then left. We were the last ones out.
Mum and Dad and Denny saw the passing out parade. Puckapunyal, it was a long march from cadets. And the 6th Battalion was the next to tour.
I travelled to Sydney for the Welcome Home parade. It brought thousands and thousands of Vietnam veterans out, and we were able to embrace them.
I didn't want to go because I thought, oh, this is going to be it. But when I got down there, I was very pleased that I did go down because it was quite emotional.
It was one of the most emotional things that I've ever been involved in, sort of marching along and streamers and people, and it was just absolutely incredible. And I mean, that gave me an opportunity to actually have the support of Viet veterans in Albany who I had never met before. I think it was beneficial for all of us, really.
I've been in and out of choppers now for months. We made our tents a home, VB.
Anzac Day's for everybody. Long Tan Day's just for Vietnam veterans. It's for us. It's for not just 6 RAR boys, it's for all the fallen.
Even the original cross was torn out of the ground, and it wasn't found until a friend of mine went back some years later.
I went back in November, and some of the officials said to me, oh, we've got a surprise for you. We found the cross. So a day or two later, they took me to a shed in Long Tan Village, and there in the shed was the cross lying on the ground in the shed on a dirt floor. What did get me was a few days later, they did come up with the plaque, and that one threw me away. When we cleaned it, I looked at the plaque. That was more a living thing than the cross was.
But the cross that appeared again in the ground at Long Tan was a replica, and